evening, everyone. I'm going to call this meeting to order. This is the City of Montpelier Development Review Board. My name is Daniel Richardson. I serve as chair. The other members from my right are
Rob Goodwin,
Deb Markowitz,
Meredith Crandall, staff,
Claire Rock,
Ryan Kane,
Tom Kester.
Right. And this is the meeting for Monday, March 4th. We're starting a little after 7 p.m. The first order of business is the approval of the agenda. There is one application and some DRB training that is scheduled. Does anyone have any adjustments, additions, subtractions that they wish to make? Hearing none, all in favor of approving the agenda as printed, please raise your right hand. It is approved. No comments from the chair this evening. The other item of pre-application business is the minutes from February 19th. Myself, Ryan, Rob, actually one, two, so, no, we don't have a quorum. So we will put those off to the next meeting. And that brings us to the first item of business, which is 29 College Street. It is a two-lot subdivision. This is a sketch plan. The applicant will come forward. I'll simply explain, because this is a sketch plan, there's no formal testimony being taken or decision being made tonight. In a subdivision application, there's a two-step process. The sketch plan is basically for the board to ask questions, give a little bit of preliminary feedback. If any of the neighbors or interested people are interested in giving feedback as well, this is a good time. It gives the applicant an opportunity to incorporate some of that feedback or engage as the project may be bettered by such feedback or as they see fit. But we don't make any decisions tonight. Following the sketch plan, we then go, I think it's a two-week gap until we do the final subdivision.
Whenever they get the,
yeah, whenever they get it.
Whenever they get the application, they get it.
At least. Yeah, they have it's, a, it's good for a,
thank usually you. A month at least.
Yeah, it's usually a month. It's good for a year, but this is the first stage of the process. So we're really here to, at this point, hear the application, go over some of the details, and voice any issues that we may have with it or questions or things that need to be fleshed out for the final subdivision. Any questions? Good. So we don't put you under oath, but would you please introduce yourself for the record?
Sure. My name is Katie Gustafson, and I work at Vermont College of Fine Arts as the Vice President for Campus Planning.
Okay. So, Kate, if you wouldn't mind giving us an overview, and is anyone here in the audience here to speak on this application? Okay. Just if you change your mind, that's okay. You're not either bound to say anything or not, but I'll make sure that there's an opportunity, knowing that there are people. So, Kate, why don't you give us an overview of what you're proposing to do?
Sure. So, we are looking to, we've been looking at the entire college campus for quite some time in terms of excess space that we have. And we have quite a bit of it. And for 10 years, we've held on to the entire campus, and we've come to the conclusion, just based on a variety of factors, that we need to sort of strategically look at pieces of the campus that we can divest of. Frail House is basically a standalone house. And so we are moving forward with attempting to put that on the market to sell it. And in order to do that, it actually shares a lot with the Crowley Building, which is the newest building on the campus that was built back in 2015, the glass front little cube building. And so therefore, I'm here submitting the application to subdivide that lot.
So the end result would be to take the, is it the Crowley House? That's being portioned off?
Right. It's that lot. It's called the Frail Lot.
Oh, okay, Frail.
We are hoping to divide it in half so that the house on the corner, which is sort of an old Victorian home, can be sold as a private residence.
And what is the house currently serving?
We house faculty there occasionally. We need to use it maybe 4 weeks a year, and need, I say loosely. There is one program, it's our largest program, the writing program, where we have 25 faculty members, so we can fill that building along with several others with them, but we have other room for those 25 people in other places on campus.
So it's being used primarily as a residential structure?
Yep.
So one of the threshold questions that we have is that, and I don't know to what extent Meredith has gone over with this, but I think this is really a threshold issue of the master plan for the college. And the AIPUD under the old regulations has expired.
Yeah.
And, but part of it is that the new regulations don't call for an AIPUD, that doesn't exist as an entity anymore.
Right.
And so there, what is the college's plan as far as, are you planning on either renewing the old master plan or developing a new master plan?
So we're in the process of developing a new master plan. It is an outgrowth of the previous master plan, trying to look sort of further down the road, since it will no longer be a document that needs updating every 5 years, but very much in the same spirit and many of the same ideas that were in the last version of the plan.
So, you have...
Well, so that's, it's a, because of the change in regulations, it's a separate process. They can't go through a renewal,
right,
a short-term renewal. And so I've actually seen a first draft of the new master plan, but it's gonna be a whole new campus PUD that'll have to go through sketch plan and final review here. And a, you know, large document that covers everything from signs to the full campus parking plan to landscaping to every potential use that they might think that they might have in the future on the campus.
Okay, so this is a longer-term comprehensive document.
Yes, much. It's intended to be looking, 20 to 30 years or even further into the future. And so we're in a sort of a limbo state for doing this subdivision.
Well, let me ask this question, and this is intended to just clarify the decision I think we have to make as a board down the line. This lot that would be subdivided, what's identified as lot one on your survey, is this the end of the campus?
Mm-hmm.
As I'm looking, Kemp Ave, property across the street is a privately owned.
Correct.
The property behind this is, looks like it's privately owned.
Correct.
As well. Okay, so this is really sort of a, we're not talking about changing the middle of the campus. This is really cutting off a logical corner of this.
Yep.
So as a board, and I don't know if any of the other board members have a question to help with this, one of the determinations we have to make is whether we want to make the college submit a final subdivision application after obtaining the campus PUD approval under the 2018 regulations, or if we allow the college to move forward with the subdivision application process despite the language in the 2011 regulation regarding no development, given the fact that we are in this sort of limbo halfway stage between the two. The old AIPUD is no longer in effect. They're creating a new campus PUD. But the question is a bit of a chicken or egg dilemma, which is, can we allow them to carve off this piece that now, prior to formal adoption, or is this something that we should be informing the applicant that they should be waiting on?
It would be interesting to get a legal opinion on this. It might inform us first question really is, are we constrained?
I mean, I would definitely have to go to ask the attorneys about that. It's, you know, I mean, in some ways, I think you're supposed to be constrained because the 2011 regulations are what govern that old campus PUD, which is what is governing the the college right now. But I don't know because that's just the whole, if this were amending an old permit granted under the old regulations, we'd be bound by those old regulations.
Right.
But a plan's not a regulation, so I could see how there might be a different decision.
Right.
You know, a plan is a document for their use that
mm-hmm.
we've okayed, and under the new regulations, there are different, there's different standards they apply to it. So
yep.
it would, so that's the limbo that I see, is that we're kind of in between regulations.
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly, I share that thought as well. And, you know, the other thing about the switch is that we're going from really very different in the AI PUD standards to the campus PUD changes some of the regulation. I think the AI PUD had a much more, not to say that as Ms. Gustafson has testified, it's going to look very similar, the two documents, but I think the regulations are a bit different.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's one of the concerns. Just a second. Any other thoughts from the board?
I would kind of, in considering this, the purpose of this no development may occur until a new AIPUD requirement from the previous regs. I think it's my reading of the intent is that unless they have a new master plan, they can't do a new building, change in use, that type of development. What we're presented with here is simply subdividing off a residential. It's a change in ownership. It's not a change in use. It's not a new building. So this doesn't seem like the type of development that would be prohibited by that prior section to me.
Yeah, except, I the history of this, and Kevin was here, he'd have, a deeper knowledge of this, but the AIPUD had always existed to make sure that the campus stayed unified. And we've always had an issue with, well before the College of Fine Arts, but when Union Institute owned it through Norwich, of certain properties being sort of carved off at the edges. And, you know, the idea, well, we're just going to exclude them from the AIPUD. They'll still be academic use, but we're just going to move them out to different ownership. And then one of the more contentious hearings we had was when the building that now houses Legal Aid, Harris Hall, which had been pushed out of the AIPUD, you know, went to its next logical phase, which was away from an academic building, NECI, to now private office building. And so it slipped out of that. That was a concern of the AIPUD. That's one of the changes, I think, with the campus PUD, is that it's not as, it's not looking to control in the same way. It's looking more for planning purposes and planning document, not as a regulatory scheme. So I think at least it's an interesting question as to whether or not this type of carve out definitely under the old AIPUD, it would be a serious question because that was what the AIPUD was intended to do. But we're in this transitional phase, and I think the new campus is a PUD is a bit more generous, which is in line with what you're saying. And so the question is, where do we really stand given this? Let me ask the applicant this, and sorry to have to, but this is the public process. Is this something that it makes sense to do a master plan before the subdivision? Or is this something that the subdivision really needs to happen first?
I'm not sure I exactly understand your question. What I would say is that the college some strategic ideas about the way we need to use the resources that we have
mm-hmm.
at our disposal. It's an incredibly challenging time in higher education. I don't know if anybody has heard the news today about Southern Vermont College, but pretty
right.
much every small higher education institution is pretty much in the same boat. BCFA is doing okay, but there is urgency to look at all of our resources and use them in a way that's going to ensure the long-term stability of the college. So we have urgency to do this. And so in that sense, we'd like to be able to do it before the campus master plan is done and approved. Simply because that is a very big document, and it just takes some time
right.
to work through that process. The way my understanding and sort of the way my thinking goes is that under the old regulations, as well as the new regulations, subdividing is something that could happen in either set of regulations. Granted, we are in this limbo in terms of the campus master plan being not current, but there's not really a scenario in which either is where you would never be able to do such a thing. So whether we go with the old regulations or the new regulations, you know, the college would very much like to have the board work through that process with us now rather than waiting for the campus master plan.
Okay.
I'm just wondering, audience members are having a hard time hearing, and I'm wondering if I should just open that wall so that we can use the speaker. They'd have to sit farther from us, but they can
okay.
hear.
Sorry, we'll deal with these technical difficulties
sure.
first.
Another option, would there be a problem to put them at the at the table?
It's fine with me.
Because there's so few
yeah.
people.
If you want to just sit up at the table.
That might
want.
Be easier, and then
yeah.
sure.
then it stays.
If everybody's having trouble hearing, they can sit up at the table with Katie.
Sorry. Yeah, 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 go ahead.
Do you want to, just so you can hear better?
Okay.
Can you hear okay?
Maybe
it's a little bit better.
I can definitely
can you
try.
Do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, having heard that, I'd like to just echo what Deb said, that it, I think if we have any inclination that we might be interested in requiring an amendment or requiring approval of a new master plan prior to considering this subdivision application, that we get a legal opinion saying that we have the authority to do that, because it's not obvious to me that we do. It's not obvious to me that we don't, which is why it would be great to have the city's attorney answer that question. But then, that said, my inclination is still that, even with what you said, Dan, we're not talking about a change of use. We're talking about a residential building that is on the outskirts of the campus that would remain a residential building. It would just be subdivided and sold. I'm not suggesting that we should require them to have approval of the new master plan prior to considering this application. But if we would like to do that, I think we should get something clarity on whether that's appropriate legally.
Let me add to that. I fully agree with both board members. Let me add to that that it might be helpful to have an understanding of the different standards for subdivision that the old AIPUD rules would require versus the new campus PUD. You know, given, and this comes into a question of, dare I say it, vested rights, but you know, I think it would be helpful in our analysis to understand, as Ms. Gustafson mentioned, that, you know, if this was allowed under the old rules, how it would work. And if it's allowed under the new rules, how would it work? Because I think, given what she's she's also said that the college, you know, this is something that is a high priority for the college. It's moving away from the need for a big campus for a high residency program to then have an understanding of, you know, it would be silly to wait on a master plan that would simply say what it's going to do on this particular corner before we did the subdivision, I think is where the board is starting to think. If we are empowered and our analysis can otherwise contemplate the other issues that would drive this type of subdivision under either the old rules or the new rules. So I would add that to the analysis. Now that's something certainly either David Rue can consider, or maybe Meredith, you can as well.
Yeah.
You know, I don't, that may not require a full legal scrutiny, but I think that that may be the best way to approach this threshold issue. So I don't know how much further we can go. I know there was a question from the public on this particular issue. Mr. Kernahan?
Yep. Hi, I'm Paul Kernahan with 14 Saban Street. I think some of the comments that you are making overlook one fact that I think was in Meredith Crandall's memo, which is that the AIPUD actually expired in 2017, June 4th, 2017, so before the new zoning regulations took effect. So it's interesting to consider what would be the situation if there actually was a master plan that was in effect now, or rather when the new zoning regulations went into effect. It would seem to me that if the college had applied for a five-year plan at that time, that it would have probably, there'd be a good argument that it would carry through under the new change of regulations. I was also just going to comment that, unfortunately, this is a situation that we've been in before. For some reason, the AIPUD process has been difficult for the college to reapply for. I don't know if no one puts it on their tickler file or if the city fails to remind them, but I've been here in this room before in other years where changes have been anticipated and people look and say, oh, the master plan hasn't been updated in, you know, 7 years and expired 2 years ago. What are we going to do? There may be some precedents there that you could look at, although, of course, the zoning changes didn't change. But B, it really would have been great if the college had kept up with the master plan process. And although it is put forth as a really onerous step, I will say again, from being here in previous years, that the master plans often look very much like the previous master plans. There aren't that many changes, and they tend to look very similar. The final comment I would make would be about the plans for this particular property. And it would be interesting to know from the applicant when it was decided that this was a surplus property, because living in the neighborhood, I know that that building was just very recently renovated and in fact integrated into the new square cube building. I saw a lot of the promotional materials about that, and it was really designed, that square building was designed by a very high-powered, nationally known architectural firm, and it was designed to integrate with the Dutch Colonial building that's there, Flail House. It was painted a similar color. You can see on your plans that there was courtyards that were designed to link them together. It was very much seen as a linked project. So it's sort of interesting to see that the college has now decided that they only use it four times a year, which does question the planning process involved. You know, why would they go through all this high-powered work to design a building that's only being used four times a year? So those are my observations and comments.
Okay.
Thank you.
If you want to, or we can wait till later. Did you want to?
Well, I thought I was asked a direct question, but
oh, sure.
Do I wait until the end? So I'm happy to wait.
You're welcome to respond. I mean, you don't have an obligation to necessarily
okay.
respond either. These are, I think, feedback points at this
yeah.
point, but if you wish to.
Well, I was going to just say that in terms of the building being renovated in 2015, what we did was paint the building. That was Martin House, which sort of sits behind, actually was the one that really got refurbished, and the one on the corner, if we had had the money, we would have done much more to it, but we didn't. So it really did, and you are absolutely right that it was looked at as sort of the three buildings together as sort of a cohesive unit of buildings. And in fact, there were additional plans to even create sort of a breezeway that may have been, like a three season porch to connect the two buildings, which also didn't happen. And again, I think in a perfect world, if we weren't in the challenging times that we are in, we might not be looking at this. But the reality is that higher ed is in a really precarious situation right now. And so
it has been for a long time.
Well, that may be. But the same people who were leading the college at the time of the renovation and this project and this vision are the same ones that are, there now looking at it and really trying to be very thoughtful about the moves that we can make that both will benefit the college in terms of our long-term stability and looking to do things that, are not like selling a building to create a hotel or a mall. It's a single-family home that very nicely will sort of be incorporated back into the neighborhood. So anyway, I just wanted to say in terms of the renovation, sadly, that one really only got a paint job, not much more than that. And just to acknowledge that you were correct, that it was seen as a vision of three buildings together. But the truth of the matter is there are only 4 weeks out of the year where we have enough faculty to fill all three of the buildings. So.
Where's Martin House exactly?
Martin House is the one that's set back. Can I come look at what
yeah.
you're looking at?
I have this here too. That might be so.
33 right here?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Perfect.
Okay. Jose, if you wanted to.
Good evening. My name is Jose Aguayo, and I live at 1 Kemp Avenue, which is directly across the street. I'm going to read something that my wife got together. She's actually ill, so I decided we just wrote a little quick sort of our opinion on this situation. And I'm concerned that BCFA has purposely chosen a time when their master plan has lapsed and the city is changing its ordinance to do this. It means that we cannot know what their intent is for the property that spans our entire front yard, our porch, as well as half the rooms in our house. I would like to see this issue tabled until BCFA has a functional master plan in place for the city. Barring that, I would ask that the property, once subdivided, be subdivided to be submitted to the zoning board to be rezoned as residential, as currently mixed-use residential, in keeping with the surrounding properties and the character of the neighborhood. This property should not be sold as mixed-use residential. It is the very outer back edge of BCFA, with our home and the Kellogg residence next door, were once dormitories of Vermont College. As these properties were sold, they reverted back to family residences and they contribute to the character and the community of the Sabin Street neighborhood. This home should be no different. If there's some intent to sell this property, which there is, to develop for some commercial use, I was told, that a cafe was going in, as one of the people who was doing the surveying work said it. I don't know where they came up with
no.
this. It would have an enormous negative impact on our quality of life. We have put a great deal of time, money, and elbow grease into restoring our home, and never intended to live across the street from any busy commercial enterprise. Unfortunately for us and our neighbors, there's no way to know what the intent is of the BCFA currently with our overall, without a master plan. This move, without any context, threatens our day-to-day peace and our considerable investment. Thank you.
Thank you. One thing I'll note is that, you know, we as a zoning board can't determine or assign a use apart from what it has as a use, and there are tables of allowable uses where, you know, if somebody has, for example, if it is a residential use, and it sounds like it's largely been a residential use, but somebody buys it and wants to use it as a different use that's permitted in the district, that's what zoning's about, is allowing those type of uses. So I don't see where we could have a subdivision, even with a master plan or without, where you would assign one use that could never change. That's just as your neighbor next door could all of a sudden decide they don't want to live there anymore, they want to turn it into a truck stop. If the truck stop is permitted in the district, that's permitted. It's not. So, and I haven't heard anything from your neighbor. But that's an example of, you know, the zoning can only go so far as to control uses. I just wanted to be clear about that.
I understand. And the concern really is that allowing the old master plan to expire at a time when they had some requirement to actually renew for another 5 years, and then leaving it into a time when we're sort of in the space of limbo. It's a concern for me. We live across the street. Yeah.
Well, I don't want to get too tied up in the master plan in that sense. In that, look, we don't have master plan police in the city of Montpelier who immediately turn on the siren once a master plan goes out of date. Nor do I think does the college. It's certainly important to keep it up to date. But, you know, this was coming in to a period in which the zoning bylaws were changing. And so if you have an expense like that, you can see where people might make rational business decisions to say, we need to wait and see what the new impact is before we invest in a process that's quickly not. And it was by that time clear that the AIPUD was not going to be part of the new zoning. So, I understand the concern of zoning, and I think this is what we're wrestling with as well. But I don't think it necessarily behooves to be too hard up on VCFA for making a decision that, you know, may have been logical at the time.
If I could just say, I actually had conversations with the city. I was alerted when I first started this job about 2.5 years ago that the campus master plan would be expiring. And having and it wasn't you at the time.
We do.
I forget what the person's name was, but saying that things were going to be changing, and so you could, you know, if you wanted to keep the AIPUD, you'd need to reapply before it expired, and then it would just roll forward, never ending, I believe, if we continue to reapply every 5 years. But the other option was to go ahead and let it expire, and then apply, you know, create under the new PUD. And so with all the other things going on, that was sort of the direction we went in. There was absolutely no, like, oh, this is a great time to, like, I wish I was that clever to be like, this is a great time to try to sneak this in. That's absolutely not it. And our hope is to sell it as a single family home. I mean, that's, we've had it assessed and you know, we've talked to realtors and that is our plan. We have no other intention, and as there's, nobody has talked to us yet, and so there's no cafe, there's nothing. I don't know, you know, where your wife heard that or
No. The company that you guys hired to do the survey.
I don't know where they got that idea, but certainly our plan is to sell it as a single family home. a beautiful house, and somebody will be very happy there, so.
No, and I think most of the neighbors would welcome a single-family residence there. That's not the issue. The issue is that I've only lived there for a certain amount of time, but I've heard from neighbors, and we heard here earlier, that there has been this, you know, friction here and there once in a while, because the college obviously is looking out for its own interests, which is what anybody does in the business. And of course, us as residents and neighbors have to look after our interests. So, you know, across the street, across College Street, as an example, you have a parking lot that we had, we talked about some issues there. And, you know, there's always issues that come up.
I think for me, this, I understand.
Yeah.
As a homeowner, I totally understand.
Yeah.
I am also a homeowner
in
Montpelier, so I understand.
I mean, you guys were shoveling, for instance, your snow into from that pergola into my property this winter until I stopped the drivers, and it was, so as a neighbor, I feel sometimes that I can't take you as, I have to know exactly what your plans are, because it makes me a little nervous. As a college,
well,
I'm sorry
to hear that somebody was doing
well, they
that.
Stopped
had I had I known, I would have stopped it immediately.
But anyway, there you go.
Thanks. Anybody else, or there'll be opportunity. I'm sure. Go ahead.
I'm Roger Kellogg. I'm in Three Kemp, just across the street, and our only concern was it's crowded. The camp is really a small place. It's at the top of a hill. Traffic is a problem, and our only concern was the subdivision, which refers to it being a private family dwelling. I know you said, well, it's mixed use. That's where it becomes a concern. It's very crowded, and especially in the winter, it's very narrow, and a lot of traffic would make it very difficult and dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
And our concern only is the use. As a private dwelling, nobody has a problem with that. If it's more complicated, then it's going to be dangerous. That'll be, it's a dangerous corner. That's all. That's our concern, is
okay.
Being in the neighborhood. That's all we have.
Great. Thank you. So I do want to ask a couple of questions.
Sure.
Beyond the threshold. And just to clarify, the parking for this would still be on College?
Correct.
I'm looking at the drawings, so the cars would come to the carport on College and near the front entrance.
Yep.
So no proposals for driveways on Kemp. And is that a two-car driveway?
I would imagine one would fit under the carport and another could fit
within the driveway.
Yeah.
The only reason I ask that is because if it is a single-family residence, most families have more than one car. Wanting to know, is this a design that would support that as it stands now. I think that would be a good point just to go out, either measure or confirm in a second. So the other plans I note from the application is that you're going to sort of peel back the patio that connects the two properties. Would that be to the property line, or would that get rid of that patio area altogether?
Do you mean the patio area in front of Crowley, the corner?
Well, I presume the patio that's facing College Street would stay as is that? But there's, I'm just looking, there's like a
connector's patio.
A connector patio.
Yeah, I mean, so on that point, I think that I would be looking to the board for potentially recommendations. One option is certainly to take it up. The other option that could work is to leave it as is, and that, you know, the college could then, I don't know exactly what you would call it, but would agree to take care of it in perpetuity, if it made sense to not disturb that section.
Sure. I mean, it does have a shared retaining wall.
Yep.
that holds up the back.
Yep.
Back hill. I don't know about the other board members. I mean, I don't have strong feelings one way or the other. Obviously, it's in the back of the house. It's really a question for the person who's going to buy it,
mm-hmm.
what they're comfortable with.
Yeah.
They may want to discourage any connections
sure.
to the college and encourage privacy. They may want to be able to put up a privacy fence.
Yep.
But at the same time, I don't think that's necessarily our issue for
yep.
subdivision. Claire.
These properties are very much interlinked with the, both the design features that were kind of referenced earlier and the retaining wall and the patio that links them together. There's also a, is it like a wire fence
mm-hmm.
that runs along the top of the
yep.
retaining wall that goes from the Frail house over to the Crowley house?
Yes.
So would the intent be to leave the fence, the retaining wall would obviously stay, but the surface of the patio would be broken up for like a visual division?
If we were required to, I think that my preference would be to leave it as is and have the college agree to maintain it in perpetuity. But if that was not either agreeable to the board or, you know, if it was approved, if it was not agreeable to a buyer, we would certainly change that.
You know, I don't know, this is a daytime cafe, so you don't have a lot of students stumbling out of it at 2 a.m, like a bar or something. It's,
pardon me, this?
The patio, it was more of a joke. It was, I know oftentimes people have concerns when they have a public building next to them to make sure that the hours that they operate.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if any other board members feel any differently. I mean, I think it's really an issue that's ultimately for you to determine, you know, if this feature makes sense or what the market would require if the subdivision was granted. Yes, Jose, you wish to?
You don't have to answer. There may not be an answer, but actually when you asked about the driveway, this is something that that spot right now has a light pole.
We're moving it. We're in the process of moving it.
So that was, my question is then would they be allowed to put a driveway in front of my house, basically?
That's not what's being represented in the plans, and that's why I said
is that allowable under, if somebody buys it, is that?
Well, anyone can apply for a curb cut. There's that's but that's not us. That's the city council that decides on that. And that's not something we can necessarily control either. There's nothing being proposed. I think it's helpful and maybe may assuage some of your concerns if there's a clear representation as to the length of this driveway. If it supports, it's like anything. If I have a driveway that supports all my needs, I'm not going to build an extra driveway. But if it's a driveway only fits one car and there's no other logical place, then yeah, I'm going to look for another driveway if I'm a homeowner. But I think that's part of the question here. And I should also say, I mean, a lot of this is feedback for the applicant to incorporate into the next phase. So certainly, I think that's a fair concern. But no one can make representations as to what the future will bring. But at least, as far as I understand, the applicant is saying they're not proposing to subdivide this with any extra driveway. And then I think the next question is that the driveway that exists seems to support more than one car, which is, you know, just getting clarification on that I think will be helpful. So let's,
so just to,
go ahead.
Just a note about the patio.
Yep.
Technically, to meet accessory structure setbacks, the patio is supposed to be 5 feet from the property line.
Would that
apply to the
fence too?
Fences can go right up too. Fences
can cross.
Fences can cross. Fences have 0 foot setback, but that's where we were coming into some issues with the patio.
Oh, okay, and we're talking about the front patio with that.
Well, the front patio, but also that shared patio, the connector patio. Even though it goes over, technically, any patio is supposed to be 5 feet from the property line.
So
I know, it's a weird
So the connector is considered a patio? connecting walkway.
A path.
So it looked to me more like a path than a patio.
Good.
It is actually, it's not the same material as the patio, so actually.
Is a path.
Is a path or.
It's really a path, okay, even though, sorry, they were saying patio on that one. Then that would be. Yeah, sidewalks, I guess. It doesn't have a walkway, but sidewalks are 0 feet, so we could stick it there.
I mean, that's what I classify it as. It's not a set your chair out kind of patio.
True. It's a space for them to get connected to, so that makes sense. Never mind.
Okay. So, has the Department of Public Works taken a look at the subdivision?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and they had fairly extensive comments about the driveway, but I think that there was some concern about whether or not, when it says reestablishing, DPW had some concerns about whether or not it was going to be a new curb cut, and I confirmed with Katie via email that you've got in the packet that it's not a brand new curb cut. So I think that, you know, we're just going to need to make sure that Department of Public Works takes a look to make sure that what's there currently fits with the current chain requirements. But I don't know, Katie, how, because it says reestablished, do you know how long ago it was used as a driveway?
2015. I mean, I think
so
it was
really
right
recently.
Around the time that we did that whole area in the new building was when it stopped being used, because the carriage house, which used to be where the square cube building is, we used to park in front of that and come in and out of the driveway in front of Frail.
The only other staff comment really goes to additional landscaping. And did the intern bylaws pass Wednesday?
I think that was just the first reading,
wasn't it? Okay.
I don't know. I think that was just, I've been out a lot with my kids, so I haven't had a chance to talk one-on-one with Mike.
Okay.
I don't know if.
I'm just wondering if we're under the sort of old.
Oh, yeah, we're still under the old regime right now.
Okay. So one of the issues with the old regime, new old regime, is there's a landscaping requirement. And so it would, we've been wrestling with it, and it talks about, and I think this is one of those projects where it's reasonable to have that analysis of what's existing there for landscaping as far as trees and shrubs. It calls for a certain number of trees per square footage.
That's site plan.
What?
That's site plan. This is
site plan. Oh, sorry.
There's separate subdivision landscaping questions.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
I'm going back into my old.
This is just on page 13. It's under design and layout of necessary improvements. So the applicant has to design the subdivision to maximize existing mature vegetation and then provide additional landscaping as necessary. And really the issue here would be maintaining and providing privacy for adjoining property owners in between lots.
Right. And so really that's just an analysis of what exists as landscaping. The analysis is actually very similar to what I was going to go into, it's just decoupled from that very mathematical equation, but really it looks to, we need to understand what landscaping exists there now. Given that you are separating this out, what landscaping you might propose or think is necessary, or a reason why such additional landscaping isn't necessary to effectuate this subdivision. That would be important and helpful to see on a final subdivision application. Ma'am, did you wish to have a comment?
I
Can you come up to the microphone and just state your name for the record?
My name's Rebecca Singer. I live in the neighborhood. And if you could just repeat what you said about the multi-use zoning that Dr. Kellogg's concerned about. We're all concerned about that. So if you could, I didn't quite understand what you were saying.
The multi-use zoning from earlier. The only thing...
That's our concern.
Okay. Well, the only thing that I said before is that, you know, the use is... What they, when you subdivide, there is usually a current use of the property that subdivision doesn't affect. Now they may, the applicant may choose to list it as a residential or a mixed use. But my point is that after, if that subdivision happens and the property goes into the stream of successive owners, that owner is not, we cannot at subdivision bind those future owners to that specific use if there are other permitted uses in that district. So just as you own your house and you could change the use tomorrow to another permitted use, going through the application process, of course, so too could this lot owner take the use that they have and change it to another permitted use. Now, the idea of zoning, of course, is to try and come up with permitted uses that fit within the neighborhood. So if you look at your particular neighborhood, the what's listed for permitted uses, I think you would generally find to be copacetic with the existing residential character of the neighborhood. You won't find industrial or, you know, fishery listed as a potential use in the neighborhood because they're not compatible with the residential uses. You know, there are other permitted uses within your neighborhood, and we can't necessarily, as a zoning board, say, well, you have that one use. That's all we're going to let you have. As a condition of subdivision, it just isn't something that would, even if we did it, it's inconsistent with our bylaws, and it wouldn't be sustained if somebody chose to challenge it, and it would be something that down the line could potentially be challenged. And that was my only point, was that, you know, ultimately if the applicant, as they're representing today, and I don't mean to open up a can of worms that the applicant doesn't want to. I just simply wanted to respond to one of the earlier points, which was to say we can't control what future users of this property will do.
Just as we can't control what VCFA will do, consistent with the regulations. The subdivision, the ownership, has no bearing on what somebody is allowed to do with their property. That's under the zoning bylaws, which we have no authority to change. We just apply. So the route to kind of limit the use of that property from what's, I guess, currently a mixed use to just residential is through the Planning Commission and ultimately the City Council to actually rezone it, to change that boundary line. But that's not something that this board can do. We can just apply the subdivision regulations, which really just makes sure that, you know, there is a use compatible with the lot, that the lot is of an appropriate size and shape and has access and those sorts of things, which nobody's raised any concerns with. The concern really seems to be about the use, which if a cafe is a permitted use or permittable use, if it's a conditional use, you'd have to go through the zoning regulations. Somebody proposing to put a cafe in, somebody proposing some change of use, they're going to have to go through some process, and you can participate in that. If somebody were to propose an application for something, that would come here. But nobody is doing that. If you want it to be rezoned, that would go to the Planning Commission.
I just don't want this to be
sure.
Cynical application. It's family, 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 sell it.
We're not, but we're not.
I'm just, let me finish. But
if somebody proposed a restaurant, you would be notified of a change in use. By the city, if you're an abutting landowner, then you could participate in that process here. But no, the point is that.
Yes.
This group, yes.
So I'm asking this group.
Yes.
But the point is that that's not what's happening. The use of the property is not part of this proceeding.
Sorry, I'm just following up that statement, but this proceeding would be necessary in order to file for that.
If VCFA wanted to change the use of the property, VCFA could change the use of the property.
But they'd have to come here, if you're talking specifically for a restaurant, they would have to come here because it's a conditional use. If any of you want to come down to our office, we can give you a list of the uses that would require a DRB hearing.
But the ownership doesn't, is irrelevant to, if it's VCFA, if it's a future owner, if somebody wants to change the use, they would have to come here. But the subdivision does not impact what uses could, the property could be put to. That was my only point.
So you don't, you're saying you don't have to subdivide those two properties in order to have the one property be commercial?
Right.
Right. Right, because that's. Because that's what it's zoned for.
And then immediately, with that in mind, oh, no, it's just family, then immediately it's a restaurant.
Nope.
We just want to prevent that.
Sure, sure.
Right, there is a select number of uses where they could just come down to the, my office, zoning administrator's office, and get a permit to change it from residential to something else. So like a, sorry, I'm looking at my chart.
A home daycare, for example.
A home daycare.
They could do without, they, any of your neighbors could just do, if it's under a certain number of kids.
So we would be warned if it was decided to become something more commercial.
That's right.
Yes.
And you would have an opportunity to participate. But if it were to be sold, for example, and became a single family resident, the next time they were looking at the zoning bylaws, you could also ask the planning commission to change the boundary so that it's in the Kemp Street boundary instead of the VCFA boundary. And that's completely reasonable, but that's not this board.
So there's two, sorry, not to belabor a point, but we're really talking about two different processes. There are the base level of rules that we have to apply. We don't get to decide which rules to apply. They just are there. The planning commission is the one who writes the rules. The planning commission is the one who determines what are known as, so there's three types of uses. There's permitted uses, there's conditional uses, and there's not allowable uses. So when I was saying before somewhat tongue-in-cheek about the idea of an industrial or fishery in this neighborhood, that's a good example of a non-allowable use. It's not allowed. You don't get to go past go. The two uses that I think you're concerned about are permitted uses, which, as I said, if you look at the chart for your neighborhood district, I think you would find that they are largely copacetic with the uses, like a daycare facility, that fit in with the residential character of the neighborhood. And then there are what's known as conditional uses. And what conditional uses are, they do require a hearing before us. And what the premise of a conditional use is to say, there's a way this use could fit within this neighborhood, but it probably needs conditions. Hours of operation, noise level, all these other type of factors that obviously are things that neighbors are concerned about that affect the character and quality of the neighborhood that spill out beyond the property. And in those situations, and I think restaurant or cafe would fit into that category here, is what Meredith's saying, is that if this property, whether it's VCFA owns it or owner number one after VCFA or owner number two, three, or four, all of them are going to have to come before us, and you'll have an opportunity. And at that point in time, they'll be proposing something, and it's a little bit easier to get your hands around to say, this will have an impact on me, as opposed to, I'm concerned that this will have an impact on me. And I think that's a legitimate concern. That's why we have conditional use hearings, is to have neighbors talk about these things, to raise issues, to say, you know, this is a really quiet neighborhood. Anything after 9 p.m. is going to be a real disturbance to this area, or parking's very tight, traffic is very heavy. you know, those kind of things are classic conditional use hearing issues that people raise. But the one thing that I think we're trying to refocus on is that at least in the subdivision application, unless they were saying we want to subdivide and change this to a specific conditional use, we don't necessarily look at the potential conditional use. It's the use that's on the ground. And really we're, as Ryan had indicated, we're looking to, does this create a sustainable lot that can function and live on its own as a separate lot? Because once subdivision occurs, it is now and forever a separate lot that can be sold and deeded outside of the chain of the surrounding land that it once was a part of. And we want to make sure that the lot we create is sustainable and the lots that remain in the larger parcel are sustainable, and we're not creating problems for either owner or their successors down the line. Does that make sense? Good. I'm glad I'm not seeing hands like I did before, so.
I just wanted to point out one thing, that if they were to go through the campus PUD master plan, it seems like by reading the way the use would change, it would just revert to the use at which, you know, if it wasn't spelled out as something different, it would revert to what's already the permitted use, not
right.
Open the door to, you know, do something less. And so,
right.
I don't know, point that out.
Yeah, no, I you know, and I certainly understand the neighbor's concerns, and I think the applicant hears it, and if anything, we've made it more complicated by talking as a board. But, you know, I think there's always that fear. What comes next if this change occurs? And I think everybody understands that, you know, our houses are our biggest single investment outside of what paltry pence, savings we've accumulated. This is important to everyone, but it's also important to the applicant as well, because this is by far their biggest chunk of investment, and they're trying to manage it wisely. So it's a matter of making sure that I think both sides are heard, but ultimately, it's driven by our bylaw regulations. Okay, thank you for listening to that last portion. I think, did anyone have any other issues on a subdivision?
No, just, I think that was around the, what is not, and this is my just note, make sure that, because it still says patio, so just change that to
sidewalk.
Walkway or sidewalk, yeah.
Yeah.
I made that note.
I think that was the only, because that's a steep slope, if they had to remove the, if it were a patio and they had to remove it, they would actually probably be prohibited from removing it because it's on a steep slope, so.
Right.
I think having it stay seems to be the best option.
I think that then removes the whole steep slope
issue.
Yeah,
that removes
as well.
The whole steep slope issue, and then, you know, it really just becomes a property transaction issue as to whether it stays or goes, and if somebody wants to make it go, then they will probably need to come for
right.
some sort of permit, but we'll figure out what that's going to be when we get the new slopes provisions adopted.
Right, right.
And we were talking a little bit about landscaping, and I would just suggest, like, just as one board member, I think it could use some additional landscaping to provide some sort of distinguishing between these two parcels. So.
Definitely.
Well, and yeah, I mean, I think the new owner of this property may want that as well. Okay, any other questions? Any other comments or questions from audience members? Any other questions from the applicant?
I would just love to understand what your next steps are. I know you've asked for a legal read, so just in terms of timeline and time frame, does that happen and then I come back for another hearing in a month and that
yeah.
all sort of happens at one time?
So here's how I would anticipate this playing out. We've asked Meredith to speak with the city council on this threshold issue, which really is the big issue for us as a board of how to proceed. Depending on what kind of answer she gets back, I mean, if the council gives a green light, I'm getting a sense from the board that we're comfortable with going forward on this. If the legal opinion is something that we need to adopt more process, she may contact you and we may schedule a hearing then, in which to outline these steps. I mean, the problem is we can't, as a board, meet outside of a warned meeting to make these decisions. But my sense is that what we're looking for is guidance from legal counsel. You know, you may also seek legal counsel to address this issue. And if so, then the next step of this is the subdivision, the final hearing. At which case, and I think, you know, you've gone through before where sometimes that can be a bifurcated meeting. And so if there's a thorny threshold issue that we need to hash out in public meeting, you know, we can have the first part of that. Honestly, I see that as the driving issue here. The rest of it is fairly straightforward. And I would see that working out at a meeting when you would choose to make that next step forward. In the meantime, of course, Meredith and you can communicate as to, you know, does legal, because legal counsel may say, oh no, it's a very clear path, this is how you do it. And we believe that the city has the authority to go forward. In which case, that will get incorporated into our next meeting. But that will give you clear guidance. If Meredith communicates to you that it is not so clear, that there may be these issues, you may seek a different second opinion from your own counsel, or, you know, recalibrate your plans accordingly. And ultimately, you can still come forward with the hearing here and say, well, I know your lawyer's saying this, but
okay,
those board members really don't seem to take orders so well. I think I can risk it. But I'm, you know, that is to suggest that the public meeting is the next step.
Okay.
But I think what we're trying to do is resolve these procedural issues so we don't spend a lot of time haggling over them or guessing.
Yeah.
So.
Very good.
Good. Any other questions? Hearing none, thank you all for coming very much. Okay, the next item of business is DRB training. Looking at the time, it's 10 after 8. How long were you thinking?
I was going to sort of fly through it.
Okay.
The materials that I developed were comprehensive enough because I intended them to be things we get to keep or go to
okay.
Potentially. Yeah. So it's going to be, you know, quick breeze through pretty much, and then
why do we do
questions?
This?
Since video is actually working this time, you may put it up on the screen so that public
yeah.
can see. Did anybody keep their stuff from before?
I did. Yep.
I missed this. When was this from?
I brought extras.
I did.
I guess I should get my extras.
Is it in the packet from last week?
It would have been from a few meetings ago. So.
Why don't we take a 2-minute break? If anybody has to use the restroom, get a glass of water while Meredith sets up.
discussions we had at the last hearing, a reminder that the deadlines that you see in the outline and the presentation, those are based strictly on what the regulations say. There may be court decisions here and there that allow for things like the written decision doesn't have to come out within 45 days. It just means a decision. So, you know, Dan circulated, I don't know if he, did you circulate it to everybody or just to me?
What?
The court case about, or
just to you.
Just to me. So there's a series of court decisions that say that when the board makes a decision in an open public hearing and lets the applicant know what all the conditions are, you've issued the decision.
Actually, can you even do it?
Well, right, but and the other thing is, if you even do it in, you know, in session, as long as there has been even just some attempt to give them oral notice of the decision, it's done. And so some courts have found that that was enough. Yes, you have to follow up with a written decision eventually, but failure to get that written decision in 45 days isn't going to void the whole thing as long as there's been some decision and the applicant has been notified. So, you know, but this layout of what the deadlines are, what the process is based strictly on the regulations. There may be some leeway here and there, but this, it is too complicated to try and go that full into that in a simple presentation. All right, so tonight, it's gonna be a really just, what you've got here is a really brief overview on the preliminary application process, and what I do before a permit gets up to you. The DRB process, if something goes to DRC but doesn't actually come to you. A slide about how things are dealt with if they have to be reviewed by the Conservation Commission, and then what is a technical review committee, because I know that question has come up before. Here is your abbreviated sort of decision map. First step, especially with anything complicated, that I really try and meet with just about every applicant, either myself or Audra, the zoning assistant, to have some sort of meeting with us to figure out, you know, what their application type is, what the fees are, what district they're in, and discuss with them the process so that they have an overview of what they're going to be doing. Then they submit their application, and then I still have an additional 7 days to figure out where the application needs to, you know, whether or not the application is complete. And then after application has been determined complete, there's an additional 30 days to figure out where it goes. I can approve it, deny it, or refer it to the DRB. And really, it's not just referring to the DRB. If it gets referred to the DRC, if it gets referred to the Conservation Commission, I've met my 30-day window. I've sent it somewhere.
Does the applicant, is that a written referral, or is that just you sending an email saying, here's DRC?
It's just a decision. It's just deciding that it has to go to the DRB. The way Montpelier works, we don't have a issue a letter that says I'm referring this to you. It's basically put it on the calendar. And you know, we let them know where it's going. You know, sometimes there have been, you know, we have discussions, we go back and forth, they get the application in, and then, oh wait, you threw this extra thing in. I can't do this as a administrative permit. And then we let them know where it's going, because we get surprises, you know. Or I'm digging through the application thinking it can be administrative, and I find some funky thing in the regulations that I can't make a determination on. And so then I let the applicant know that, oh, wait, it actually has to go to the Development Review Board. So I have a 30-day window to do that after determining that the application's complete. It can sometimes be a little fuzzy whether or not something's complete, but we do our best. And this just, you know, I've tried to throw in here what happens, you know, if an action doesn't happen in time, as well as
flag in when the, what the appeal periods are. So for zoning administrator process, if I've determined it's an administrative application, but I deny the permit, there's a 15-day appeal period. And that 15-day appeal period also applies, and you'll see it later, if I issue a zoning, you know, an administrative permit, there's a 15-day appeal period. All right, next one, which is the DRB process, much longer, clearly. I tried to color code things here a little bit, but it might have made it a little too busy. So shortcuts to the complete zoning permit application submitted for the first block. And then there's, you know, we usually have a little window of time to review that application in its complete state before we have to submit the notice of public hearing. But it can be a couple of days, it can be 4 days, it depends on how the calendar has all worked out and when they've given us the application. I've put in here when hearings have to be noticed, you know, when things have to be submitted to for the Times Argus, when things have to be submitted to abutters, just so you have that all in here if there's any questions about that. I've included when DRB agendas are posted in case anybody has questions about that. I think that's more for the public, really, than board members, but just so it's all mapped out here for you. I think you're pretty familiar with the DRB process, but do you have any questions on, you know, how your process works once it gets to you?
As far as the abutters, is that something that you, the applicant doesn't have to collect that information and you do that?
Technically, they are supposed to provide us with the abutters information. Technically, it's their responsibility. What we typically do is they can ask us to give them a starter abutter list, so we can pull that information, but what we're getting is what we have from the most recent grand list for property owners. That's not necessarily up to date, so we get that to them if they've, you know, it's a complicated situation or if they ask for it, and we usually offer. And then they'll take that and go to the assessor's office to update it or to track down. That's their responsibility. And then they have to provide us with self-addressed stamped envelopes. And then we mail out the notices. Some towns put that notice all on the applicants. You know, Montpelier's pretty big and can be complicated.
Right.
So I don't think it makes sense to have them mail it. We want to make sure we know it gets mailed.
Right.
You know, that's like in some towns, the notice that has to be put up on the property about there's going to be a hearing, the Z notice. Some towns, the zoning administrator is the one who actually goes out and puts that up on the property.
Oh.
We can't do that here. We just don't have the bandwidth.
Right.
So that gets mailed or, you know, hand delivered to the applicant, and
right,
it's their responsibility to put it up.
But it is important to have the applicant themselves be the one to generate the abutters list, because any mistake in that generation will affect the application. And
yeah,
ultimately, at the end of the day, that's something that you want the abutter to carry that responsibility, I think.
Yeah, so we, you know, we'll give them a starter list.
Right.
But
yeah,
we every time we let them know that it's not, this is not necessarily the official list.
Right.
Because they're going to be more familiar with how far their property goes back or who touches or, oh no, the Strongs sold their property to the Joneses last year.
Yep.
In theory.
Or so-and-so, you know, condoized.
Yeah.
And there's actually, you know, 5 owners there now.
Right.
Because we don't, you know, as long as the number of units haven't changed, we don't care if something gets condoized.
Yep.
Okay, so there's that. And then, so.
Yes, I had a question on that other slide.
Yep.
So when it says the hearing, within 45 days after the close of the hearing, the DRB issues a written decision.
Yep.
And then that written decision has a 30-day appeal period. And then a zoning permit is issued based on the DRB decision.
Mm-hmm.
Is that an automatic thing, or do they have to come
Automatic.
And when is this, does the zoning permit get issued at the end of the 30-day appeal period? Of the DRB appeal period?
No, not necessarily. It's, when it actually gets issued, it sometimes just kind of fluctuates with when everything is going on, but it can be issued the exact same day we get the written signed decision, depending if there's no conditions. But there's also sometimes, so you issue a decision. The decision says within 60 days, you have to submit to the zoning administrator X, Y, and Z, or you have 60 days to, you know, get your master agreement that includes all of the easements. We're not going to issue the permit before that comes in if that's a condition on the decision. So there's, the window is flexible. It depends on what the conditions are that have been placed on the decision. If,
but I guess my question is, because I know that this has come up in other towns, that you wouldn't concurrently run the DRB appeal period with your zoning permit appeal period.
We're not going to wait. It's two separate actions. We don't need to wait for the decision appeal period to then issue the permit. It doesn't. It may, if the decision gets appealed, and the permit's already been issued, then the permit's basically on hold. You know, we can't enforce anything. Jurisdiction's been taken away by the court, right? So I mean, that's,
if the permit's been issued, the permit's been issued.
Right. The permit's been
issued.
The
landowner can proceed with the permit. Nothing's on hold unless the environmental division issues a stay of the permit. So
right. I mean, I think.
The day,
correct,
after we issue a permit, and that, so the, like, a zoning permit appeal period would be,
right,
a not, like, one of these non-discretionary permits. If Meredith just issues a zoning permit for me to build my single family residence on,
right,
3 acres, then there's a 15-day appeal period of that.
Right.
That doesn't ever come here, that's just that. If it comes here, then the relevant date is the day we issued a decision. That essentially is the approval.
Right.
Right,
but
there's,
so my,
but there's
my
the
question
separate
is
permit.
The,
right.
What the time frame is, because I've worked with a zoning administrator in another town, and we were told by our municipal attorney, like, don't do those, don't stack them up together. Like, let the DRB appeal period run 30 days. Then you issue your zoning permit, let that appeal period run for 15 days, and that way you're in the clear. So, like, an applicant would think, oh, like, you could say to an applicant, you'd realistically have an approval on your DRB approval to actually go ahead and build 45 days from the date in which your decision was issued. So I'm just trying to understand,
that would be the super careful way to do it. I don't think you have to do it that way.
So there have been instances where people go ahead right away because they feel confident about the permit they just got.
Right, and that's at their own risk.
And then,
right,
they lose, and then,
yeah,
they've got to undo what they've built. It's rare,
right,
but it has happened.
Yeah.
Right. So I was just curious on how Montpelier fell with, like, being like, well, we're gonna kind of stay safe and stay on the, like, you know, like, the outside of it, or just running things kind of concurrently to kind of get people so they can have their appeal.
Yeah, I mean, we just right, we get them their permit once they've met any potential conditions on the decision, is the way it's been going since I've been, you know, before I've been here.
Yeah.
And with the warning. Every, you know, they get warnings, hey, there's an appeal period.
Right, like, just
it's,
so you know.
There's an appeal period, you know, even though nobody came to the hearing, they could, you know, appeal it, and so it's at your own risk.
So that window of having an approved done deal really varies on, like, stuff, capacity, and how you're moving through it. It's not like a set time frame based on set appeal periods. It's kind of like a rolling.
I'm sorry, I'm not sure I'm following which thing you're asking is rolling. So there's not, it's very permit specific.
Right, I guess that,
and
I
decision
guess that's
specific.
What I was trying to better understand is that there's no clear time frame. It is very permit specific based on when they'll actually get their done deal. In, it's all final, nobody can appeal it anymore, you're, like, completely in the safety zone.
Right, and that's, I think, because we make sure everything has what their appeal periods are on it.
Yeah.
So the.
So I mean, the permit gets issued, the decision, so for example, like, an application from last week, we vote, the decision gets written up, and then I, as a chair, sign it, and it gets issued.
Right.
Yeah.
Starts the clock.
Right, 30-day DRB.
But they have their permit now, that gives them their permit, because that's our final decision. It just means that there's 30 days that are running. Now, Meredith is always very careful to tell them that there's a 30-day appeal period window that is open. And technically, the permit's issued. So if you feel lucky and think it's a low risk, or for whatever reason you choose to build, it's not as if Meredith's going to say, the appeal period hasn't run yet. Yeah, you can't get started. You know, they have their permit. And so I think it's always this sort of running, at least the way I've always understood the office is, you know, we just keep those things running. And if there's conditions that they have to meet before it becomes absolutely final, those aren't necessarily going to be conditions that are going to toll the appeal period.
Well, they wouldn't toll the decision appeal period. I mean, technically, when there's that kind of a gap, there's a separate sort of more... my understanding is that there is a separate, like, appeal window on the permit we've issued based on that decision.
But
it's more just to say that there would be more of an appeal of what you issued here in this permit isn't consistent with the
right.
decision. It's not an appeal of the whole decision.
Right. I don't necessarily know. I mean, you know, most of the conditions are things like, you know, you have to get your Mylar.
Right.
And so... can't see somebody necessarily appealing a permit on that.
Well, right, and I'm including it here as comprehensive. The big
right.
one here is the 30-day appeal period,
right.
and that's what
I mean, that's
gets
what
flagged for people.
That's
right.
what everybody looks for.
Yeah. Any other questions on DRB process? And you can also, you know, we can have individual questions and stuff later, too, and this will be something that will be tweaked as needed. So design review, this is design review committee flowchart and administrative process when the DRB is not involved. So something comes in, it's an administrative permit, or maybe, you know, it's just design review committee. That's the only thing that's flagged. They're coming in, they want to put, you know, a sign in, and they happen to be in the design overlay district. So usually those, we can get an application for design review and get it on the immediate next hearing. So it could be, you know, just 10 days later that it gets in. And because design review committee is an advisory committee, we just have to post the agenda, you know, 48 hours before the hearing. Usually it's about 3 days ahead of time. And there's no notification of abutters, nothing like that. They just have to put up a notice of the property. They don't have to mail anything. And then we take it in and take in what DRC has said, if that goes through, and then, you know, issue our permit with, we usually include something similar to what you guys see for a staff report, if it's a minor site plan. If it's just design review, we usually just attach the design review recommendations and issue that with the permit. It's pretty straightforward. Now, this is new from the 2018 regulations, the Conservation Committee having formalized review process.
Well, that's interesting.
There are very specific instances in the regulations when an application needs to be forwarded to the Conservation Committee. It's most often has to do with PUDs or subdivisions that have some sort of, you know, wetland or vernal pool or something that's identified on Montpelier's map, the Natural Resources Inventory map. it has to be on the natural resources inventory map almost 100% of the time. So if somebody comes in and says, hey, there's actually a vernal pool there, if it's not on the NRI map, we don't have jurisdiction over it. They would have to then go and get that map updated. So that's just big picture thing to keep in mind. So they have some really, we haven't had to deal with this yet and figure out how to actually make this work with the DRB public notice process. So it's going to be interesting to see how much this actually delays things. We actually had a meeting with a member of the Conservation Committee last week to just talk about this so that they have an understanding of what their scope of review is, and whether or not they need to draft some of their own regulations to figure out how this is going to work. You know, with regard to the determinations that they're going to need to make about, you know, undue adverse impact and how they're going to make that kind of determination, because there are criteria within the regulations to help them with that, but, you know, they're supposed to be the experts. And so we, you know, both zoning administrator, myself, and you will be relying on them to provide that information.
Their review is not like the DRC review. It's not, an application isn't being, like, referred to them.
I have to catch that it needs to be referred to them, and then I'll be referring it to them. But how that's going to work with the DRB process, like the timelines they put in here are a little funky, because the way this is set up, I would need to notify the Conservation Commission at least 3 weeks before their hearing, and their hearing is going to have to happen before your hearing, and hopefully enough in advance so they can work their comments into a staff report. If not, it's just going to be, you know, bringing them to you at the DRB hearing. It is like the DRC in that they're supposed to see it before you, but the timelines are different. And so figuring out how this is going to work in practicality is going to be interesting. Because so it's 3 weeks, you know, 21 days before the CC, before the Conservation Commission hearing, they're supposed to get the application referred to them. And then they have an additional 7 days after the Conservation Commission hearing to get comments to me and to you. So that's a, you know, 4 week window before the DRB hearing. So it's going to slow the process down for sure. Usually when I send something to Department of Public Works or call a technical review committee, which is all department heads, I can do that within, you know, a week, 2 weeks, get, you know, it's 7 days, we're going to get this, you know, just make this happen. Or sometimes they just send comments via email. This is going to take a lot longer. But it is also for bigger projects, typically. So I think the applicants are going to have to just learn to live with it or petition to get it changed. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see how it works out. We haven't had a whole lot of PUD requests so far, which is when this is going to, I think, be the biggest issue.
So if we're expecting maybe something will come in on Sabin's Pasture at some point, and so this would be an example of where it might.
Yeah. So there's that. I don't know, it's been in the press here and there about I don't even know what they're calling it. But a new planned unit development that was going to be for small homes. I can't remember the group.
Tiny houses.
Yeah, and we weren't necessarily going to be tiny houses, but very
cottages,
close to that.
Like cottages?
Cottages.
Where was that going to be?
And I think it was in the press about them thinking up.
Crestview?
Also up there.
Yeah. And there's in potentially coordinating with the city about a city park type thing. And so, you know, that has there's a potential to maybe make use of the conservation PUD for something like that. So that would require Conservation Commission.
We've had applications for up at the top of Main Street
mm.
for
So that would, if that's something that's on, yep, that would be something that would be considered, for sure. So I've, you know, mapped it out, sort of decision tree here, but it's how it's actually going to affect the process is not quite clear yet.
Well, I mean, and part of this, I think, is gonna come out in practice, and the question's always gonna be, what applications can the Conservation Commission provide, just like the DRC, provide meaningful findings, constructive process, as opposed to, you know, and a lot of the projects we're sort of speculating about seem like those ones where there is a natural feature, there are considerations, and their scrutiny would benefit the project.
Well, and one of the, in addition to those, the other big one, any request for a waiver to remove woody vegetation from within riparian buffers has to go to the Conservation Commission. So we haven't gotten one of those yet either. That would be a smaller, in some instances, a smaller project could qualify for that. But we'll see how it all.
Sure, but it's a very specific type.
Yep, that's a very specific one. But we'll see how it all, how it works. And then I know that there have been questions about the Technical Review Committee and how that actually happens. So I tried to just sort of outline it here. And that it's an advisory staff committee, so it's city staff, representatives from city departments. It is not, you know, it's not DRC, it's not the Conservation Commission. So there's no public notice of meetings, there's no requirement for minutes. You know, I usually take some sort of notes for my own edification and to be able to summarize things and get comments from the department head sometimes in writing. And so, you know, we've had instances where the public have put in public records requests and specifically said, hey, we want minutes. There are no minutes. I can, you know, if I've written something up, I can shoot it to people. But typically, the main department that I work with really is Department of Public Works. They're the ones who have concerns on, you know, almost every application. But for a full technical review committee, that would be for a, you know, a big planned unit development, stuff like the city garage. It's Department of Public Works, Police Department, Fire Department, Building Inspector, Health Officer, Community Development Specialist sometimes. If you're dealing with something where maybe it would be helpful to get additional, you know, help the applicant with some additional grants, or, you know, just advise them, you know, in things where it might need to be coordinated with something that's going on in the city. And, you know, the TRC has specific boundaries, and they're, you know, just like the Design Review Committee, their comments and recommendations aren't binding unless the DRB rolls it into a condition on a permit. And, you know, I usually try and summarize what's said within the staff report, but then when they've given me written comments, I try and attach those as well to the staff report just so it's all part of the record. I know we had questions about TRC before. Does anybody have any tonight?
Is that a meeting that you have to coordinate on? It's not like a standing committee where they get together to talk about other things and then you just jump in and share an application?
No, no. So most applications, I will just shoot off, you know, hey, here's the application, here's the packet. These are the things I think you might want to take a peek at. Usually it's Department of Public Works, sometimes, you know, fire chief and police chief will get that as well when I'm just like, can you take a quick look? Because I want to make sure you don't have any issues with this. And then there are the situations where it's a big application and you want everybody to come in and meet in person. And when you do a meet in person, usually we have the applicant come as well, and any other, you know, major players that need to be there.
So the city attorney is not part of this.
Right.
And so
it's at least so far. I mean, there might be an instance where we do pull in the city attorney.
So you have the ability to, you know, we have a question that we have, you know, raised like tonight, to just put in a quick call and say, hey, could you take
it
back and give advice?
You know, and I probably should have done it for this one ahead of time. Honestly, not my finest hour, but yeah. I have authorization to go to city council, the city's council, anytime I need to. for a quick question. And there's several times where I've done that, just be like, can we actually do this?
Yeah.
And that's also, it's helpful, you know, I also consult a lot with the planning director, with Mike Miller, to, you know, 'cause sometimes he'll know, you know, he'll have something just in his history where he knows that we've gotten an opinion from the attorney before that something is okay or shouldn't be allowed. But we're also dealing with new regulations.
Right. Well, and frankly, sometimes we're able as a board to make that decision and determination. It's just, I don't think, tonight, I think just went a little beyond what any of us were comfortable doing.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes sense to put the question before us. And frankly, that's what sketch plan is for. So.
Yep. Well, and that's because this was sketch plan, it felt like.
Yeah.
And yes, there's enough attorneys here that maybe somebody would know. But not. Okay, did anybody have any questions on that? Okay.
I guess I have one question on, like, the once the application is complete,
mm-hmm.
so whether, I don't know, someone sees a public notice or they get a letter because they're in a butter, are they instructed to come into the office to review so it's not available, like, because the staff reports are available, like, when the agenda is posted?
Yep. So the application materials are, as soon as we have them in the office, they're available for public view. Once we have, and you know, people can come in, we can make them copies. If we have stuff electronically, we'll send it to them if they ask. And once we've sent out the public notice, we try and close the application in the office. You know, if nobody has come in to ask any questions and the applicant is responding to something we ask them for, sometimes we'll put it in, but typically
someone
then
does
it's closed.
Have to request or to come in to see the entire application, which I think makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah, they can come in anytime the office is open,
right.
And say, hey, what do you have for applications? Because we also have a big, have you been in the office?
I've not. No.
Okay.
I should come by.
So there is a, you know, I call it sort of like the hearing table. So there's a table that's set up with rows for DRC and DRB where we have all the applications for those committees laid out. And then there's a big whiteboard on top of it that has the hearing dates and says what applications are up for what dates for which committees. So, you know, anytime the office is open, people can come in and take a look. And then they also can, you know, look at agendas that are posted online.
Do you guys ever think about putting the DRB agendas on front porch forum?
I'm not sure. I guess we could.
I don't know if that makes a lot of opinion. I think Jamie.
Yeah, Jamie handles the front porch forum for the city,
yeah.
And I'm not.
I just from like a public like participation and like what's going on in Montpelier, like it doesn't seem like I just feel like there could be other ways to help inform the public about what's going on. because it seems like if you're posting two of the agendas already within this building. And one at the high school, I just like wonder like how do people know?
So the city website, and people can subscribe to be notified when things get posted on the city website for specific committees.
Oh, so that's good. But you have to go and like sign up yourself
there's,
for something.
There's that.
So basically, when you sign up for any of the notifications, you get to choose all of them from all of them. So if you want to be notified of when you can't park in the street, you know, when you go through that application, there'll be an opportunity to get notified of these other things.
So you'll get you can choose to be notified
of
all DRB.
You could be choose mm-hmm. to, you could choose to have notifications for things every day. You know, if you wanted to.
Yeah. You know, some people are engaged in that.
That's right. That's good.
It never fails to amaze me after a DRB hearing who will stop me on the street and say, I saw you on the DRB hearing last night. And
something to explore. I'm not, I don't know if.
One thing that I guess I would, sorry, I'm,
no,
I
go
would
ahead.
Just throw out there is that one thing you have to be careful about is in opening up into a new posting creates a new requirement for you
mm-hmm.
on top of everything else, because once that becomes sort of an expected form where those notices are received, then if you miss it, it may not legally affect anything, but it might cause people to go, well, they didn't post
yeah.
it on this site where I was expected to, not realizing the difference between what they're legally obligated to do and what's
right.
kind of convenient. And I guess it's a question of, are there a lot of people saying, I want to know more about DRB meetings, but I'm not hearing about them? In which case, you know, there would be a reason to put it on Front Porch Forum. Otherwise, I don't know. I find, at least having been on this board, that the interest in this board really grows or wanes with the specific application projects. You know, like, as you've all now gone through with the city garage, you know, that brought a lot of attention and a lot of people and a lot of discussion. The Front Porch Forum had no problem posting about that because everybody was really concerned about it. Whereas, you know, tonight there was some attention for the VCFA, but, you know, if we have a private application, it's going to be even less. You know, it just, not every week are we doing the most exciting thing in the world. Sometimes we're just permitting people to do what they want with their property, and everybody's fine with that.
Well, and that's, you know, when, especially if it's a municipal project and it's really big, like with the garage, there's a lot more coordination with Jamie, with the city, to make sure that the city website is completely full of everything that's going on, with a forecast of here's the upcoming, you know, potential hearings and here's the process, because there was a lot of need for information for that. You know, I mean, that's my concern with Front Porch Forum is like you said, a maintaining that all the time, and the confusion of what we have to do versus what we're just doing for standard practice. And also that Front Porch Forum does have more of a needing to potentially track responses, track comments. It becomes another avenue of discussion that might end up going to Jamie or somebody else versus in our office, and keeping the lines of communications, avoiding confusion, as well as also just having the bandwidth to manage it. I think we still need to get a handle on just managing the departmental website appropriately.
And the Conservation Commission review. And
yeah, I mean, there's a lot of administrative stuff that still needs to get dealt with.
Yeah.
But it's something to think about, whether or not where things get posted should at some point get tweaked. You know, is the high school really a good place still? Or would someplace else make more sense?
Right. That to me just seems like a weird place to post the DRB kitchen. Like, how about the library?
Well, I think, yeah, but it's also a question, I think, of a public building and something where there's a, you know, broad enough segment of the city population going in and out. And that might be one reason they picked the school. I think it's been the school for a very, very, very long time. I don't know when they, other than like when the city got a website and started posting on the website, I don't know when they last changed where things got posted.
Right.
Yeah. Well, and I mean, even the public posting laws have changed.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's one of those things that you don't want to mess with that until you know you're absolutely sure you have to.
Yeah.
Or that it's no longer necessary because mm-hmm. it's that time. You forget to post that meeting and it can create chaos. Good. So
I just a heads up, the other two things that you got.
Yep.
And I'm not really, unless people have questions, I'm not going to talk about them in depth. So the little green sheet. This is more something that Audra had developed for applicants to give them really a just broad step back from the picture,
what's going on and how do we make decisions about your application when it comes in. So it's not really detailed, but it lets an applicant know what's going on. You know, does your project even require a permit? You know, if it does it already comply with the zoning regulations? If so, then you're just gonna get a quick administrative permit. If it doesn't comply with the regulations, then you may need to get, basically, you know, go through a full application process and go to the DRB hearing or go to a DRC hearing. This is really big picture simplified.
Yep.
And then, of course, you have, and I borrowed this from the zoning administrator's handbook, your great, big, complicated, here's everything flowchart that takes a while to piece through. It has references to state statutes, whereas my PowerPoint had references more to our, you know, Montpelier zoning regulations. This is really handy and helpful, but it's even more dense than what I pulled together for the PowerPoint. So, you know, if you ever want to look at really big picture plus detail, this is where to go. I find it useful. I've got it up on my wall in my office. But I tried to break that down into smaller pieces that were a little easier to digest.
Great.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Meredith.
Sorry, that took a little longer than I intended.
No.
Oh, so that was really helpful. Good.
We drove it with a lot of questions.
Good questions.
All right. Our next regular scheduled meeting is Monday, March 18th, 2019 at 7 p.m., our normally regularly scheduled time. Do I have a motion to adjourn? Or does anyone have new business that wished to continue this meeting?
Make a motion to adjourn.
Motion by Rob. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Tom. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. We are adjourned. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.